physical suffering. It may be a time of doubt about values that we have cherished as sacred in the past. Fidelity in a marriage situation. Commitment to religion in a parish setting that does not excite you. Or dedication to a job under changed circumstances and with all the avenues closed. In each and every case, we do not know where to turn. People have problems with their faith in their process of maturation. They question their values, their faith. They find themselves confused. More serious is the obscure situation we all go through. We think of the professionals who work daily with test tubes as we prepare for the COVID issues that are stating us. They must know exactly what is going on, but sometimes we wonder. But this kind of one-sided thought process does not work in the field of interpersonal relations. How can we lose, or how can we keep the values that we love and our faith alive even when we are tempted by these issues of obscurity, confusion, and even doubt? Today's liturgy deals with this very problem. Prayerful reading and listening may shed some light on it for you this morning. I certainly hope it does. Of you my heart has spoken. Seek his face. It is your face, O Lord, that I seek. Hide not your face from me. Our liturgy this morning is in the book All Creation Sings. I hope you all have a copy. And we'll be sticking to the liturgy that's found in the books. And the readings will be a little bit different than what's printed for you. They are the prescribed readings for the day on the book that's on the altar. And Nancy Hill will be reading that today. We begin on page 8. Let us please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess our captive sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, by the passion of your blessed Son, you made an instrument of shameful death to be for us the means of life. Grant us so to glory in the cross of Christ, that we may gladly suffer shame and loss for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our mission statement: we are all God's children. God commands us to tell all people that Christ Jesus is Lord. As committed followers of God, we will reach out to all people to teach the gospel and to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of our lessons this morning. Our reader is Nancy Hill.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God put Abraham to the test. He called to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son Isaac, your only one, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah. There you shall offer him up as a holocaust on a height that I will point out to you." When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. Then he reached out, took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he answered. "Do not lay your hand on the boy," said the messenger. "Do not do the least thing to him. I know now how devoted you are to God, since you did not withhold from me your own beloved son." As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram and offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did in not withholding from me your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obeyed my command." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the greatness of your compassion, wipe out my offense. thoroughly wash me from my guilt, and of my sin cleanse me. Be merciful, Lord, for we have sinned. For I acknowledge my offense, and my sin is before me always. Against you only have I sinned, and done this evil in your sight. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. A clean heart create for me, O God, and a steadfast spirit renew within me. Cast me not out from your presence, and your Holy Spirit take not from me. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. Give me back the joy of your salvation, and a willing spirit sustain in me. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all, how will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen one? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? Christ Jesus it is who died, or rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Then Elijah appeared to them along with Moses, and they were conversing with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He hardly knew what to say. They were so terrified. Then a cloud came, casting a shadow over them. From the cloud came a voice, "This is my beloved son, listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone but Jesus alone with them. As they were coming down from the mountain, he charged them not to relate what they had seen to anyone except when the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept quiet and kept the matter to themselves, questioning what rising from the dead meant. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. From the shining cloud, the Father's voice was heard. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. Grace, peace, and mercy from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. We've been talking these last couple of months on what on earth am I here for? We're trying to figure that out. I still haven't figured it out. I'm 71 years old. I still don't know what I'm on here. All I know is that I'm here to praise God and to do the work of the Lord, whatever that takes. But you know, that's a big pill to swallow, isn't it? It really is. So we want to talk about the whole idea, what on earth am I here for? You're here for a purpose. You're here for a purpose. God just does not create something out of the void. God is very, very clear and specific. Look at Genesis. He created everything down to the minutest of the minute. And he saved the last for us, for the best. He created you. And he created you, God created you in the image of God. You are a part of God. And so, it all starts with God. It all starts with God. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. See, it all starts with God. And whether you want to believe it or not, it's all going to end with God. It's all going to end with God. Now, you can believe that or not, but it is true. It all starts with God. And you have a purpose. And I hope you're trying to discover that purpose, because that's what life is about. Life is about discovery. I enjoy children. I am so glad we have our after-school, preschool program next door to see their little faces. They love to ask questions. They love to discover what happened to us. We don't like to discover anymore. So many of us have stayed in our home since March 23rd, 2020, scared to come out. And I understand. I understand the panic. But we have to realize, what about those who have to work? Our firemen and policemen, our sheriffs, our school teachers, our preschools, all of our programs, the stores. How would you have ever gotten your food from your grocery store if no one showed up and they decided to stay in the home? What would happen? You may have the luxury to lock yourself in your home. But God tells us, and God shows us, we need to get out into the world. Into the world. Not of the world, he says. God says, into the world. That's why he sent Jesus. He placed Jesus into the world to show that God was in the world, that God is with us. Emmanuel, God is with us. And God is with you. Now, I want you to think about seven things this week, one each day. First of all, I want you to think about what is your purpose in life. That's where you start. Why on earth did God place me here in Riviera Beach or Palm Beach Gardens or West Palm Beach, wherever, Singer Island, I don't know where, New York, New Jersey, wherever it is, why? Because that's what a child would ask. Wouldn't a child ask, why, God? Why, God, did you place me here? Why, mommy, are you my mommy? Why, daddy, are you my daddy? They have so many questions. And then you answer their questions and they come back with, but why? And the answer is simply this. God loves you. Because God cares for you. cannot isolate ourselves. God calls us into community. Communion. God calls us to be with one another. And we cannot isolate ourselves. Well, we can, but that's not what God calls us to do. God calls us to be in communion, not only with God, but with one another. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have the gift of everlasting life." That's communion. "I came so that you may have life . People, it's not about you. It has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with God and others. Point number two. You are not an accident. You are not an accident. God created you because he loved you. And God gave you a mom and a dad, hopefully. Nelson and Harriet. May they rest in peace. Three brothers, Joe, Randy, and my brother Robert, or Bobby. Isaiah 44, "I am your creator, you are in my care even before you were born." Even before you were born. Long before you were born, you were conceived in the mind of God. Can you get that? That's awesome. Did you know that? Even before you were born. Psalm 139. Look at it. Point number three. What drives your life? What drives your life? When you leave here, where you're going? What drives your life? What are you going to do tomorrow? What drives your life? What are you going to do this week? Ecclesiastes says, "I observe that the basic motive for success is the driving force of envy and jealousy." Chapter 4, Cain and Abel. Cain slew Abel. Why? His younger brother, because he was jealous. Here we are in the first four chapters of the Holy Book, and already there's murder and deceit. Many people are driven by anger and resentment, and you're looking at one. I get angry over the smallest things. The other day we have a three-way stop in PGA National. Okay, it was only a one-way stop. You could go straight through. Well, people still go straight through because they don't know the stop signs are there. Now, I don't know how they don't know, because the stop sign is red. And PGA National also put red lights around the sign that blinks on both sides. Now, I come up to the tee, and what are you supposed to do? Take your turn, right? Well, over to my right is a tractor that has a mower on the back. He goes through, I start to head out, and the next car behind the tractor races through. I laid on my horn, I was so angry. She wouldn't look. I was just upset. What gives her the right? She could have caused an accident. Anger and resentment. That's a big one. Most people are driven by fear. If anger and resentment doesn't get you, fear will. Fear is simply false evidence that appears real. False evidence that appears real. How many of you are afraid of COVID? That's false evidence that appears real. How many of you are afraid of taking the shot? They're saying that 70% will not take the shot because it hasn't been tested by the FDA. Many people are driven by materialism. Yes, the almighty dollar. How much can I make? And we're never happy. The government tries to set a minimum wage, and now they're raising it to $15. And it's going to affect businesses and the whole economy. They're going to have to let people go and go to automation. Nothing matters more, people, than knowing God's purpose for your life. And nothing can compensate for not knowing that purpose. Many people are driven for the need of approval. That's me. That's me to a T. My two older brothers, Joe, the firstborn is always the worst, right? He was always in trouble. He couldn't do anything right in my parents' eyes, especially my mother. Bobby came along and he couldn't do anything wrong. Honor roll, straight A student. So I see Bobby, and I mean Bobby and Joe. Well, I'm the third born, I'm the middle son there. Well, what do you think I do? Nothing. I do exactly what my parents tell me. Gary, go to the store, yes, okay. Here's the list. Gary, mow the lawn. Okay, Mom, Dad, yep. Gary, take the trash out, yep. And that's where my need for approval came. I want to please you. And being a parish pastor for 45 years, that's pretty hard to do. Three parishes, nobody's ever happy. The message is either too short or too long. The communion rye is too strong or too weak. The wafers are too dry or too wet. The carpet should be green or red or blue, but not the color that it is. The pews are uncomfortable. The organist is wonderful. You're welcome. We need approval. And some of us will go to any lengths, and I'm one of them. Well, those are the first three things you need to work on. But you know, when you work with God, God gives you benefits. Amen. Now, I was a federal employee for 20 years at the VA Medical Center chaplain. We had five chaplains, and one of the wonderful things about the government is they give you benefits. And do they give you benefits? Before I even started to work, my first week, you had orientation, and my very first day, they said at 8 a.m., show up at H&R. I said, before, we want to go over your benefits. Okay. So I show up, she says, have a seat, sits me at the table, and carries out a stack, and I mean a stack, 6 inches high. Of benefits. I said, what is this? She said, well, these are all your benefits. I said, what? She said, well, some of these things you got to do 30 and 60 days or you lose them. Well, I've got a pension. And then I can contribute to the pension. And if I contribute 3%, they match a 3%. Up to 5%, they match 5%. I was getting 5%, getting 10%. Not bad, huh? Healthcare. I feel so honored. But yet, when I see people without it, I have 12 choices of healthcare. And I could do it every year, change my health provider every year. During open enrollment, long-term care. I don't want to go on, it just goes on and on. And then they add more and more benefits every year. Then you get a 3% cost of living. Guaranteed, because it's the government. Guaranteed, plus you get 13 days off a year, every holiday. Isn't the government wonderful? in debt? Does anyone know? Do you know how much we're in debt today? Over $30 trillion and heading upward. You know what that works out to be? About $5,000 a person, something like that. But there are benefits to being with God. There's benefits to the purpose-driven living. There's benefits. First of all, knowing your purpose brings meaning to your life. It brings meaning. Knowing your purpose simplifies your life. And I need a more simple life. Knowing your purpose helps you to focus. And I need that. Knowing your purpose prepares you for the life after this life. Think about your purpose. The verse here, you, Lord, give perfect peace to those who keep their purpose firm and put their trust in you, Isaiah 26:3. Point four, you are made to last forever. Is that new? Isn't that a revelation to some of you? You are made to last forever. Now, I know you're going to say, Pastor, nothing lasts forever. I just bought a new car and it broke down the first day I had it. A new washing machine. You know, they don't make things like they used to. Well, they make them so they'll go obsolete today. And on top of it, they come out with a new phone every 6 months. And new technology. And they're not cheap. $1,000 here for a phone? Wow. But you were made to last forever. You have no expiration date. You may think so. God has planted eternity in the human heart. Ecclesiastes 3:11. This life is just preparing you for the next. Yesterday I was honored to be in the public square and the Girl Scouts were selling Girl Scout cookies. It's Girl Scout cookie time. And of course, a little sweet little girl in her uniform and her mother, do you want to buy something? I said, I'm on a diet with a hair. Gave her a couple of bucks and said, add it to your collection. When you live with God, your values are going to change. Think about your purpose. The world is fading away, along with everything it craves. But if you do the will of God, you will remain forever. 1 John 2. So here's your question. Since I was made to last forever, what is the one thing I should stop doing and the one thing I should start doing, especially during this Lenten season? Point number five. Seeing life from the eyes of God. See, we don't look at life like that. Have any of you noticed the beauty around you? The bluebirds that sing, the flowers that grow. We live in Florida. They even call it paradise because things grow crazy. Look around you. See, it's not about you. But we never do because we're so focused on what's going on today. We're so focused on that. Character is both developed and revealed by test. And all of life is a test, people. Life on earth is a trust. If you don't believe it, Genesis 1 again and 2. God created the heavens and the earth, and he said it was good, and he said to you, be fruitful and multiply, take care of what I've given you. I trust you with what I've made. So what does Adam and Eve do? First, Adam complains he needs help. He doesn't thank God, he complains. Sound familiar? And then Adam and Eve get together and say, wait a minute. Why can't we have that tree? They didn't say, you know, you can have everything else in the garden. They just said you can't have the tree. So what do they focus on? The tree. And then they talk, probably for hours. You know, that's what we do, don't we? We contemplate for hours, thinking we know better than God. Should I eat that tree or should I, you know? Then the whole story, is Adam to blame or did Eve to blame? What difference does it make? They ate. They disobeyed God. That's the point here. They disobeyed God. And because of that disobedience, there's consequences. You know, when I didn't do it like that, when I didn't take the trash out, there were consequences. I didn't do that again. Life is a test and a trust. The verse to remember here, unless you are faithful in small matters, you won't be faithful in large ones. Luke 16. So the question here to ponder, what has happened to me recently that I now realize was a test from God? What are the greatest matters God has entrusted to me? I've shared with you time and time again, being a pastor, Scripture is very clear. Or a deacon, or a Christian. If I lead one of you astray, it's like a millstone hung around my neck. Point number 6, life is a temporary assignment. It's not permanent. Of course, we don't like anything temporary, do we? Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be. Remind me that my days are numbered and that my life is fleeing away. Psalm 39. Your identity is in eternity and your homeland is heaven. Life is a temporary assignment. Notice the word assignment. Now in school you had assignments. I love to procrastinate. I would even wait till the very last minute to get my assignments done. That's why I was a BC student. I never learned that if I did it early and let it go, I'd probably be an A student. Earth is not our final home. We were created for something much, much better. Our verse here to remember. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. 2 Corinthians 4. Your question here? How should the fact that life on earth is just a temporary assignment change the way I am living right now? Finally, in. You probably couldn't wait, right? There's a reason for everything. There is a reason for everything. You may not think so. God doesn't operate by coincidences. God is very specific. There is a reason for everything. Everything comes from God alone. Everything lives by God's power. And everything is for God's glory, Romans 11. The Lord has made everything for his own purpose, Proverbs 16. It's all about God, it's not about us. Living for God's glory is the greatest achievement we can accomplish with our lives. I want to repeat that. Living for God's glory is the greatest achievement we can accomplish with our lives. It's taken me 71 years to get that through my thick head. You know, you wear the collar and you think you're almighty. You know, everyone's so passionate, how are you? You know, treat you nice, even in the stores. And it goes to your head. You know, why are they treating me that way? They should be treating everyone that way. So the question here is, how can I bring glory to God? How can you bring glory to God? Well, one way is what Nancy did, reading, being a deacon, reading the lessons, picking trash up around the church. It drives me crazy because it's always there and people walk right by it. Genesis, we are to take care of what God has given us, and we are not doing a very good job. When everything in creation fulfills its purpose, it brings glory to God. We bring glory by loving other people. We bring glory to God by loving other people, not just our husbands and wives and our parents and children, but others. John 3:16 again. But yet, 70% of our marriages end in divorce. Does that tell you anything? We bring glory to God when we become more like Christ, His Son. We bring glory to God by serving others with our gifts, the Lenten discipline, giving alms, talents, prayer, giving, not receiving. It's more blessed to give than to receive. We bring glory to God when we tell others about God's saving love and grace. And that's the biggest secret of the church. And we don't share it. Look at it. Look around. Where is everybody? Well, they're probably at Target. They had a big sale at Kohl's. Right? Isn't it on Walmart? That's the big one. Or Amazon, right? Everybody, Amazon carries everything. They never have time for God. So the question for you this morning, and I'm going to end this, is what will you live for? What will you live for? Jesus will give you everything you need to live for Him. It's all about God. For everything comes from God alone, everything lives by His power, and everything is for His glory, Romans 11. So the question here is, where in my daily routine can I become more aware of God's glory? I hope to see you next week. We're going to continue this. Next week we're going to talk about you were planned for God's pleasure. Amen. Almighty God, we thank You. We thank You for being our God. Help us to be Your people and strengthen us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our service continues with the hymn of the day on a hill far away.
hearts to prayer, one of the Lenten disciplines. There is power in prayer. Prepare your hearts. Prepare your minds to talk with God. Let us pray. Relying on the promises of Almighty God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need.
Your gift of grace is for all people. Give confident faith to all the baptized, that they may follow you wholeheartedly. Give new believers joy in your promises. Give hope and courage to those who suffer for their faith. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
All the ends of the earth worship you, from galaxies to microorganisms. Preserve your creation. Teach humanity to wonder at your work and to join you in tending to creation's well-being. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You rule over nations. Raise up advocates for peace and justice within and between nations. Give life where hope seems dead. Call into existence new realities we cannot even imagine. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In Jesus, you joined humanity in suffering and death. Reveal to all the depth of your love shown on the cross. Accompany all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Restore all who are sick or grieving. Bring vindication for victims of injustice, exploitation, and oppression. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You made Abraham and Sarah the ancestors of a multitude of nations. Bless grandparents, parents, foster parents, and the children who look to them for care and guidance. Console those who deal with infertility, parents who have entrusted their children to adoption, and children longing to be adopted. Equip ministries and services to families. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We await the day of Christ's coming in glory. Lend us by the example of all the saints whom you have called to us by example, and take up their cross and follow you, that together we may find our lives in you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of mercy and new life, you love all people whom you have made in your image. Empower your faithful people to stand in solidarity with all those oppressed because of religious identity. Deepen respect, community, and love among all those who seek justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We now ask God for anything that is on our hearts today. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O Lord, faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The offering is before you. There are two plates. The gold plate is what stays here to maintain and to take care of us. But the other side is for others. And this week, all monies that go into that basket are going to Houston, Texas. If you're not aware of it, they were devastated by the snows. They weren't used to it. They live, some of them still did not have power, they didn't have water, they lost a lot of food, they lost a lot of important everyday things. They need our help. One way we can help is by placing a dollar in that plate. so that we can mail it down to them and hopefully put a small dent. Remember, it's not about us. It's about others. Let us pray. May this sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify your faithful in body and mind for the celebration of the Paschal festivities. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
We greet one another with a sign of peace. God's peace.
The Lord be with you.
To show even by the testimony of the law and the prophets that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so, with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth and pray your majesty without end. We acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink of it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the memory of me." We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim is death until he comes again. Save us by your cross, set us free. Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate today, whom you led through the passion and death on the cross, to the glory of the resurrection, and whom, when we have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again. And we offer you the bread of life and the cup of blessing. Look upon favor of your church and all who gather here this morning. And grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit may we be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we celebrate. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire us in words and actions. Comfort those who labor and who are burdened. Make us serve them truly, after the example of Christ and his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. Grant also to us, when our earthly walk here is over, that we may come to your eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory and praise is yours, now and forever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come now to the table of the Lord, for all has been prepared for you.
This is the blood of Christ.
God, in this holy communion, you have welcomed us into your presence, nourished us with the words of mercy, and fed us at your table. Amid the cares of this life, strengthen us to love you with all our heart, serve our neighbors with a willing spirit, and honor the earth you have made. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We certainly want to thank you for worshiping with us. We certainly hope that the service this morning was meaningful to you and to your worship life. Please prepare yourselves for the blessing. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and power and glory and might and peace, and grant you everlasting and eternal life in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us. You all have a blessed day. Our closing hymn, Lead Me, Guide Me. Lead Me, Guide Me.
Thank you. Thanks be to God.
Thank you again for worshiping with us.